Welcome to episode 26 of Nui Sports TV. I'm Ty Steadman. Let's get straight into it. It's not even 9 o'clock yet. This isn't midnight. This isn't one of those half-asleep, crappy-ass videos that I normally produce. Today, West Walls End versus Cooks Hill United, the only match of the day. Old Boys Day at Johnson Park. And appreciation to West Walls End for allowing me to run the PA out there, even though I was wearing Cooks Hill gear. So to any of the old boys who aren't familiar of who I am and what Nui Sports is, it does happen. I think it was a fair enough, I was fair on the microphone. Cooks Hill, they did win some grades, we'll get into that, and I didn't, I just announced it. I try and stay professional. If it's an away game especially, I don't want to cause too much of a scene, especially if I'm running the microphone for them. So appreciations to that for West Walls End, and I'll be back out there on either Tuesday or Wednesday night, maybe even both, but it's definitely been a ground that I feel very at home at. Free entry, free food, lots of people being thankful for what I do, so Westie's been one of the better community clubs, I think, this year. And one of those really important key things in all that is the way they've improved this season at Westie, especially in the 17s and indeed the 19s for that matter. Let's get into the 17s game. West Walls End 3 defeating Cooks Hill United 2. This is one of those times where I don't like reading the score out because I feel like I should go through the game because this was a hell of a match. For any neutrals that were there, I saw some players from Lake Macquarie City there. I saw some players from Walls End. There's a lot of 17s players that get out there and watch opponents and whatnot, watch the other games in the competition that was happening today. So for those guys, especially Lakes, they would have been, happy and then sad at this result, and Walls End would have been, this was definitely a finals preview and it played out like that. Cooks Hill, a battle with another top four side. They started the better of the two teams. They started very well, high spirit, and against probably their biggest test of the season, or one of their biggest tests of the season. Both teams defending strong. Toby Mellon, I thought, was playing really well for Cooks Hill at left back. They'd get probably the best chance of the first half. Eli Collins with a late chance just before half-time. After the break, Westie came close to scoring, but some last-grasp defending from Dominic Noonan kept it level. Westie would get that goal not long after half-time, though. Grant Scott putting the ball in after a scramble in the box. Moments later, Cooks Hill, Cameron Walmsley hitting back, scoring another goal. I don't know how many that is for the season. Just for the sake of it, I'm going to check, because I feel like it should be mentioned that he is now on 18 goals for the season across the two grades that he's played in, which puts him in fairly high order. Cooks Hill's second best goal scorer is on 11, so Cameron Walmsley definitely the golden boot winner there at Cooks Hill, barring someone scoring a double hat trick on the last day of the season or so. Where am I? 3 minutes later, after Cameron Walmsley's goal, the visitors grabbed a deserved lead. Fergus Allen, who was a standout on the day and a very decent player, put Cooks Hill 2-1 ahead. Westie's premiership hopes circling the drain at this point. 2-1 down with 10 minutes to go. Needing a win, they'd staged one of the best comebacks I've seen this season. Kai Drayton beat the keeper from range, caught the keeper out, I guess, and Jared Hayter would score with 4 minutes to go, a header, another scramble in the box. Oh, I think it was just a dangerous ball in, really. And out of nowhere, Westie go from 2-1 down to 3-2 up. And, well, what do you say about that? I don't want to end, I don't want to spend only 4 minutes talking about this game, but that's what it's looking like, because that's everything. But what I wanted to point out is this 17s competition. Well, that result right there, that opens a door for Cohiba tomorrow, who are travelling to Singleton. I'm going to take a quick look at the ladder. Cohiba definitely a team to watch in the 17s. And quite frankly, the top four might not be settled at the moment. It might not be all settled, all said and done. I don't know what I'm trying to say, but Cohiba will jump Cooks Hill United tomorrow if they beat Singleton. I don't know if... I don't think either of those teams have a game in hand, so I think Cooks Hill's finals hopes are in a real sort of troubling... I wish that the table that I looked at didn't have a points differential or anything like that. I'm going to quickly try and find it. Let's talk about West Wallsend. They'll go into the finals. They're still premiership, you know, Don't say the word minor. It's not a minor premiership. It's a major premiership in my mind. I don't like the word minor premiership. It's a rugby league term. I'm a rugby league fan, but, you know, to be the best side all season, you deserve to be called the Premiers, and West Wallsend are still in with a chance of being called the Premiers in the under-17s competition. That was a huge win today. Probably their biggest win of the year, to be honest, considering that they were down 2-1 with 10 minutes to go. You can't go wrong with that. And we take a look at the ladder now. This is what it looks like, nonetheless, if you can see that. Cohiba FC are coming for Cooks Hill United's final spot. So as it stands, in the under-17s, if Cohiba win every game, they will make the finals, and Cooks Hill will not, unless Wallsend fall away. So that was a big, big loss for Cooks Hill today, dropping all 3 points. And yeah, the door's open for Cohiba. It's going to be interesting to see what happens over the last couple of weeks. Cohiba indeed do have that tough test next week against Wallsend. Let's move on to the 19s. Let's not spend all night on one grade. Big win there for Westie. And a big win in the 19s as well. Matt Turner scoring the only goal of the game. Cooks Hill with a depleted side. You know, players playing in higher grades and not being forced to play 19. Some were. Ty Cousins played all 4 games, I believe. Oh, I don't think he came on for first grade, actually, but he, again, had a very busy day. the 17s defensive line backed up for Cooks Hill, the likes of Dominic Noonan. Names aren't coming to my mind at the moment, but most of them were there. Sam O'Sullivan came on off the bench. Jared Neal started up front. Makeshift team for Cooks Hill. Both sides playing an attacking brand, which was good to see. Jared Neal would get injured and replaced by Carlo Proietto. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. I've been saying it like that all year, so who knows, but I do like that sort of pronunciation. Carlo came on, and I think Jared Neal was playing all right, but Carlo is not really a striker, I don't think. I don't know if he stayed there, but Luke Slay's long-range shot was a chance of the half for Cooks Hill as he took advantage of Matt Pennington. The West Wallsend goalkeeper he collided with a Cooks Hill player. He was left down. He was sort of getting back up and had to scramble back towards the net to send this one wide. It was a quality save, too, from being injured and somehow getting back and saving it. Early second half goal to Matt Turner would give Westie the lead. Cooks Hill, you know, they threatened, but they really didn't have that sort of striker that they needed up front. Sam O'Sullivan got a look at goal late on, but he's a defender from the 17s team, and defenders normally don't score goals, and he produced a fairly tame effort in a very, you know, should-score situation. Cooks Hill fall to another frustrating loss, whilst Westie take a huge step towards finals. A loss here would have it would have opened the door for South Cardiff tomorrow. That door is still not exactly closed, but West Wall's end 9-inch. We've won two games remaining. They got Bell Swans midweek, which is tough, but they've got Cessnock next weekend, which in my mind they're probably going to that one as favourites. Some important games though coming up. The under 23s, West Wall's end 1, were defeated by Cooks Hill United 3. Cook is looking to take another step towards sealing a potential top 2 spot, and they did just that. Jai Blanche got a goal for West Wall's end early on. Collided with Kaya Roth, the Cooks Hill goalkeeper. It looked like Kaya was going to be gone in the 11th minute, but he battled on. Less than a minute later, Cooks Hill would score an equaliser. Steve Koulis' header after a scramble inside the penalty box. A fairly even first half, but Cooks Hill would take the lead into the sheds at the break, Elijah Harrison grabbing a goal just before half-time. And after the break, straight away, Sam Pateman got a penalty. I don't believe he earned it, but he converted it nonetheless. I'm not sure who earned it, to be honest. None of the games were filmed today, by the way, due to excessive amounts of wind and my cameraman, you know, deciding that we'd rather not have to listen to wind in the match videos. That happens. Westie, they fell off the pace in the second half of the 23s. Just not really up to the challenge, you know, 3-1 down. It's going to be very hard to come back from that. Sam Hawke blew one or two chances. Hitting the post and missing an open net towards the end for Cooks Hill. But all in all, it was a solid team effort from Cooks Hill against an understrength West Wall's end side. Cook is looking to build some form, of course, going into the finals. We'll move on to first grade. We're making record time tonight. West Wall's end 1, defeated by Cooks Hill United 3. Now let's get into this, because this is going to be a very long sort of segment. This was pretty much, for me, this was West Wall's end B team versus Cooks Hill United B team. For any neutrals who might have been there, they would probably not have been very impressed. Looking at the team sheet, I just thought, wow, this is incredible. Probably combined 13 or 14 first graders out across both sides. Westie with some players suspended, injured, players at Splendor in the grass, you name it. Cooks Hill just... And I thought, I seriously think that if Westie were full strength, Cooks Hill would have been in some real trouble today. It was a very poor preparation. I didn't see too much of what was going on in the West Wall's end camp, but Cooks Hill, just the warm-up, you know, players pulling out on the day. Another, you know, I'm not going to name names, but another player who I've heard might not be back this season. Jack Wilson, the club captain, out. You only need to look at this Cooks Hill team sheet to just realise how much of a hole they were in. These are good players, don't get me wrong, they deserve to be there, but to have this many 19s players come into first grade is crazy. Especially, you know, Bailey Graham, first grade starting debut. Emerson Gosling, first grade debut in goals. Luke Slay, first grade debut. Just amazing. Absolutely amazing. If not for Mal Hinchcliffe, the Cooks Hill average age probably would have been 19 or 20. Still might have been, I don't know. But it was a very, very inexperienced Cooks Hill side. And admittingly, it was also a very inexperienced West Wall's end side. Sam Jones, Luke Patton, Greg Mason, Jake Sills coming off the bench. You know, more than that, but they had plenty out today, Westie, you know, not just, you know, Jared Olivieri, Ty Jones, Ryan Cole, they're all big names that were out. There were several others that were out today. I can't think of who, but there definitely was. Michael Bailey was probably Michael Bailey and Tyler Warren, of course, in goals. Grant Morrow, I guess you could say, is recognised first grader, Ryan Van Kemenade, but a lot of youngsters in that Westie side. And so for my mind, we'll talk about the result actually first. Westie's Sam Jones looked to have scored early on, but the Bluebells would be caught offside. The ball was in the net though. It was some cheap defending from Cooksill, very poor. The offside flag, as I said, it was denied by the offside flag. And then moments later, Thomas Sparre scoring for Cooksill. Pacey attacker who just got away and never looked back. Hammered it in off the post, a very nice goal to watch. Hit the back of the net very hard, sort of. It would have been a very good goal on video, especially from where the camera is normally set up there at Westie. It would have been very nice, but we didn't film any of the games, unfortunately. Tyler Warren copped a knock to the head, the Westie goalkeeper, and he looked destined to be substituted. It went on for about 3 or 4 minutes. I think he had a cut behind his ear, so the blood rule, and you can't just take your goalkeeper off and not play with a goalkeeper for 2 minutes while he gets strapped up or whatever. I thought that the youngster Josh Sneddon might have been required, but Tyler Warren would continue. And it was a lengthy pause, and I think Westie got the best out of that pause because they came out firing, and Dom Langowski would fire in an equaliser. Some poor defending from Cooksill, admittedly. 39th minute, that goal was, and moments later, Cooksill would take another lead. A scramble in the box, and of all people, Mal Hinchcliffe scoring again for Cooksill. A sort of backheel slash flick into the net. Big Mal getting another goal. Two goals in two games since taking over as captain coach. The pace and enthusiasm of a makeshift Cooksill side was too much for Westie in the second half. As I said, one of their more experienced players and, you know, the leader on the pitch, Michael Bailey, the captain, he was involved in what I'd call some silliness. Verbally questioning the referee using explicit language, that's probably a very, very descriptive term for dissent. And, you know, last week, this is some of the inconsistency I don't like. You know, this isn't just because Cooksill, whatever. I've seen it a lot this year. Last week, a player was sent off, straight red card, Peyton Tagarulius at Cooksill, for similar, for swearing towards a referee, supposedly. And this time, Michael Bailey gets shown yellow. And I think that's fair enough. I think if it's a frustrated, you know, F-bomb or something thrown in there, fair enough, a yellow. I don't think referees should be giving out red cards for dissent, straight red cards, unless, of course, it's, you know, completely over-the-top sort of abusive, threatening language. That may change, though. The English Premier League, I know, bringing in some new dissent rules, which will probably filter down to our federation eventually. He got yellow carded, Michael Bailey, and then, if that wasn't bad enough, 2 minutes later, he just come in late and just collected a Cooksill player, and he was sent off. And on a yellow card, 2 minutes after it happened, you can't come and cut, you know, barge players off the ball late on. It was a late challenge, it was a sloppy challenge, and it was a red card, and disappointing for West Wall's end, yet another red card. It's been such a similar story this year, you know. So many players suspended, and that does not help. He will miss the last game of the season, I believe. They've got midweek game, excuse me, but it probably is his second red of the season. I wouldn't be surprised, so he may miss the last two games of the season. I'm not sure. All in all, don't worry, I'm just completely lost. Westie struggled with only 10 men on the field. Ryan Van Kemenade got on the end. Some decent build-up here. Some tricky stuff going down the wing. Good ball in. Van Kemenade with the header. It wasn't to be. Cooksill eased to a 3-1 victory. They weren't really pressing too hard. They weren't really being pressed too hard. I wasn't too impressed to see Cooksill go to the corner with about 5 minutes to go and park the bus. It sort of ended up there, but, you know, I don't like seeing that. At 3-1, you know, I really thought Thomas Sparre should have got a hat-trick on the day. Cooksill probably could have pressed a bit higher against 10 men. understandably, I can't say that word, not taking any risk, you know, 3-1 up. But again, I'd be one of those who'd take those risks against 10 men and try and get a couple more goals. And even first half, but honestly, a very poor showing from Westie in the second half, just a little bit off. And I think the players in that Cooks Hill team, both teams had inexperienced players, but I think the Cooks Hill ones, without sounding too harsh, were deserved of being there. West Wall's End, you know, some of their 23s coming up, you know, onto the field, they're sitting second last. To be fair, you know, there's not much Westie could have done. Maybe give some of their 17s players a go in first grade, I don't know, but some of those players haven't really, you know, Cooks Hill, guys like Ty Cousins and Asher Beasley and whatnot have been in and out of that first grade squad, Seb Lewis the same, but Westie definitely didn't really rise to the challenge once they were 3-1 down. And they'd fall to a defeat at home on Old Boys Day, which I'm not sure. I don't know if it was poorly advertised or whatnot, but it was a very quiet turnout for Old Boys Day. I think that the best game I've been to at Westie this year in terms of crowds was the Walls End Derby. And I think West Walls End, and Walls End for that matter, they're thinking wrong if they think anything but scheduling Old Boys Day on Derby Day. That's what it should be every single year, home and away, at the Gardens and at Johnston Park. Old Boys Day for the Wolves End Derby. That's what I'd certainly be doing. But Westie fought sort of hard, but not hard enough in the end. And Cooks Hill, this really surprised me today, Cooks Hill. It was very, I saw that very ill-prepared sort of game, and they stuck to a makeshift squad and really proved themselves today. A very, very good win, a much-needed win. And, you know, you can't go wrong with that. With that many 19s players starting, 3 players on debut, and get the win. Admittingly, it wasn't against a very strong Westie lineup. As I said, it was essentially Cooks Hill B versus West Walls End B. But Cooks Hill got the job done on the day. NPL results, this is off the top of my head, so I unfortunately don't remember the lower grades, but today the Maitland Magpies defeated the Lambton Jaffers 4-1 at Arthur Redden Oval. Which normally I wouldn't even mention that, but that is a big, big win for Maitland. Getting towards finals now, and for anyone who didn't take Maitland seriously, then now is the time, with guys like Matt Thompson, Ryan Broadley, who else in that team? There's plenty in that team. Ryan Clark, I believe he's there. I'm not sure. Just plenty of talent in that Maitland squad, and to beat the Jaffers 4-1 at Lambton, that's very hard to do. So some credit to the Maitland Magpies today for that win, Maitland FC. I like the Maitland Magpies name, so I'm going to stick with that. Tomorrow, I don't know why I'm saying this, because this isn't going to go up until Monday night, but tomorrow, South Cardiff versus Walls End, our feature match, and 3 other games on around the grounds. All that to be covered in the next portion of this video, which will begin very, very shortly. That's Saturday. Sunday's coming up next. I'll see you in a little bit. Welcome back to episode 26 of Newey Sports TV. I'm Ty Steadman. Today, South Cardiff versus Walls End FC. Got the jacket on here, the Gunners. Look at that. So that's what every club now in the division. I also got a nice South Cardiff shirt. I'm actually thinking of wearing a TAFE sometime this week. I don't know about Supporter 2016. Well, I guess. I was definitely hoping that the Southie sides could get some decent results today. You know, I like Walls End, I like Southie. I'm not going to be biased towards either of those, but you know, I was hoping Southie 19th would get the win, and we'll talk about that soon because I really want to see some competition for the finals. We'll talk about the under-17s first. South Cardiff 0 defeated by Wallsend FC 4. The last time Nui Sports went to South Cardiff, which was, what, 2-3 weeks ago, Southie just had, they had 10 players in this grade, so today they had, I think, 13 players, and then one or two that were out injured or suspended or whatever the situation was. I don't know where they got those extra players from. They must have had a few out that day that I was there. Justin Becker was a starting goalkeeper today. This is a side that's had every man and his dog in goals this season. Ethan Spears, who has been regularly featured in goals as of late, wasn't featured in the squad today, but we'll get into it. In the 7th minute, Jacob Ray came very close to opening the scoring. I'm not sure if the highlights are going to be back this week. I didn't get the time to edit them last week, but if they are, then here's the highlight. Baraka Berindwa got into an attacking action. That's really not the right word there. I don't know who wrote that. I wrote that. We'll move on. A quick counter. Saw Travis Lockwood find Dan Strizari. I'm going to go Strizari. I think that's what it is. I don't know, you can tell me 100 times the correct way to pronounce that, and I'll get it wrong every time. But a name that I somehow can pronounce right is Baraka Berindwa every single time. Just rolls off the tongue, doesn't it? A perfect through ball from Strizari to Berindwa. The pacey winger was too quick for Southie. His cross found Jacob Ray, who just sort of, I don't know, thrusted the ball into the net. It wasn't really a kick, it wasn't really a header, it was just, I don't know, hipped into the net, like bodied into the net. I don't know what the word you'd use. It was really a casual sort of finish, but it's all it really needed to be. It was on a plate. So 1-0 to Wallsend in the... Oh, pardon me, that is incorrect. He actually missed that chance. The chance that I'm talking about is the one we're going to look at now in the 19th minute. A poor turnover from Southie gave Ben Priest the ball on the edge of the box. He got it to Strizari, and his pinpoint cross found Jacob Ray, who, again, as I said, I put it as a tap-in here, but it wasn't really a tap-in. It was more of a bodied into the net. Just, I don't know. I don't know the correct term for it, but it definitely wasn't. It definitely wasn't a boot on the ball. It got into the net anyway. That's the important thing here. Wallsend were the better side, the likes of Southie captain Daniel Perks and Jack Harris, and I thought the defensive line there for Southie working very hard. It'd all go south very quickly for Southie. In the 24th minute, a Dan Strizari shot was backheeled off the line, I should say, by Finn Merrick. Baraka Berindwa had a follow-up chance blocked by Merrick. And the ball was finally put in by Bailey Rufo despite a attempted save from Justin Becker. 2-0 Wallsend in the 24th minute. In the 34th minute, here we go again, a brilliant through ball from Ben Priest set Cooper McLean off, and his cross was parried. Just can't put words together tonight. His cross was parried by the keeper directly to Drew Masady. Drew Masady jogging on the spot, 3-0 with a simple tap-in. I thought Justin Becker here, the goalkeeper, you'll see in the video, if he hadn't have made contact with this ball, it probably would have gone to safety via the boot of Daniel Perks, who was behind him. The goalkeeper just sort of, maybe, you know. But again, with a ball flying across goal, the goalie's probably got to go for that regardless. In that situation, that probably would have ended better if he didn't touch the ball. Right before halftime, talking about goalies, Cameron Jefferson-Bilb pulled off a brilliant a double save, which you'll see here, denying a quality strike from Lucas Emmett-Morlay, and then a follow-up effort from Kyle Bauer as well. Brilliant stuff from the Wallsend keeper, and then bang, straight up the field about a minute later, right on halftime. The goal of the round, the goal of the day for my liking. Ben Priest, another pinpoint ball He had a really good game today. And Jacob Murray, he'd score a bomb goal from long range to put Wall's End 4-0 ahead. And I do like that about the highlights and the videos and whatnot. It does give me a chance to mention who gave the assist and whatnot. I'm not always watching every time, you know. I do miss a lot of goals. Not too many highlights to mention in the second half. It would stay 4-0. You know, Southie probably did a very good job of keeping it at that. I thought it was going to be, you know, 6-7-8. Wall's End, a superb job in the second half. Just a brilliant display of just grinding the other team into the ground, not giving them a single chance. I think you could sort of, and you know, I may do this, if I get the chance, I may edit some highlights of the final 2 minutes of this game, because Wall's End were passing the ball around brilliantly. I thought it was just quality work, quality practice ahead of finals, just to sort of toy the opposition, I guess. Just play with possession and play smart. 4-0, you know, no stupid conceding goals to make it 4-1 and wrecking what is essentially a clean sheet. It was a brilliant display from Wall's End today in the 17s, and one that, in my mind, books their spot in the finals. If they beat Cohiba next week, they're definitely in. But in my mind, they're already in. They're deserving of being there. We move on now. South Cardiff in the 17s, you know, admittedly not their day. Josh Allen went into goals as well. I forgot to mention that in the review. Changing goalkeepers, of course. They do that a lot, but it wasn't the best day, but this was my last time watching South Cardiff this year, definitely for the 17s, because they're not going to be in the finals. But a team that, you know, I think I've watched them three times and then 20 minutes as well in one game where I had to play the same day. What I was doing playing at 9:30 in the morning, I'll never know. In pre-season as well, who books that? That was crazy. But that was a fixture. I didn't really get to see them play that day, and then I didn't see another Southie game again until about round 12, round 13. So very irregular. And, you know, leaving Yallingar Oval today, I thought I really should have got to more Southie games at the start of the year, because decent club, decent side. And, you know, I ran the PA out there today, which is 7 out of 11 grounds where I've done the job as a PA announcer, which I'm very thankful for. I enjoy doing that. And that club there, you know, they've been in the NPL and that, but they're really community-based, sort of really nice club, underrated in my opinion. And the canteen was getting a lot of praise today, and the ladies in the canteen, just hard-working people there, really, really hard-working people. And I really hope, for their sake, well, I don't know, I'd love to keep working with the club next year, but if they go to the NPL1, then I probably won't too much. I don't work too much with the top grade sides, but you know, it'd be good to see Southie go back up. I don't know, they don't know, no one knows, someone somewhere knows, maybe. Let's get on with it. Under 19, South Cardiff 2 defeating Wall's End FC 1. As I said, I'm not going to lie, I was hoping Southie would get the win here, because I want to see this finals race go down to the line. And unfortunately for them, Cohiba and Westie also won this week. Westie do have Bell Swans midweek. South Cardiff can still make the semi-finals in the 19s. I'd like to see it. This is a decent team, with some players in this team who I'd have at a club if I was running a club. Players like James Wooten, Isaac Roman, even Alex Howe, you know, good players and a good team. And if they are to make the finals, they are going to need to beat either Bell Swans or Lakes, or possibly even both. So I don't think they will, but they've come awfully close to South Cardiff 2-1 over Wall's End. They needed the win. It started really badly, Jake Sullivan scoring for Wall's End in just the 6th minute. Then in the 10th minute, Cal Stokes went off injured. He was injured not that long ago, I remember. I'm not sure what happened there, so he's obviously back. I don't know what the injury was. I've seen a lot of injuries. The 19th grade at the moment is just, it's last man standing. In all seriousness, there's been some real serious injuries in the 19s this season. There's been games abandoned. Three 19s games have been abandoned. No other grade. So, coincidental, yes, but we're going to talk about another pretty gruesome-looking injury later on in the 19s at Lakes. So Cal Stokes got injured. Jeremy Wan, not Wan, it's Wan. I learned some of the pronunciations today. He was on for Stokes, but Jake Sullivan, I thought, was playing pretty well. I wrote that down, one or two neat passes down the flank. For South Cardiff, Adam Nicholas was tricky in attack, causing some real headaches to the Wall's End defenders. Half-time, 1-0 lead for Wall's End. Southie hit back. A very, very questionable call by the referee that put them in a decent position, and the resulting free kick would eventually be headed home by James Wooten for his 15th goal of the season, the top goal scorer at South Cardiff and the Golden Boot winner at South Cardiff, unless Ben McCabe scores 6 goals in 2 weeks, which I don't think is going to happen. It could. I don't count finals as well, so, you know, it's first past the post in the regular season, and it's James Wooten, 15 goals, you can't go wrong with that. Whilst Wall's End were appealing for a harsh call, there was no excuse for the next goal. Poor defending on the corner proved costly. Alex Howe would slip a ball into the net at the back post. Goals in the 45th and 48th minute, Wall's End from 1-0 up to 2-1 down. Sloppiness proved costly, as I said. Dylan Merrick, better known as Reggie, the goalkeeper for Wall's End, produced some quality saves. It was just raining down at times. Wall's End, I thought, were poor in the second half compared to the first. I have to be honest with that. James Wooten, he had a shot tipped over the bar, and then he had an acrobatic sort of chance. It was saved well by Merrick in goals. Jeremy Wan got a late chance to draw, but it wasn't to be. And in my mind, that second half, Southie probably should have ran away 3-1 or 4-1. They definitely were the better side in the second half. Maybe not in the first, but definitely in the second. And they got the job done today, and it was good to hear that South Cardiff song one more time this year. I still can't make out any of the words. It was quite a decent, loud-sounding club song. I think I've heard every club song this year. You know, I've heard more than, you know, I've heard some club songs more than others. The Cahiba one I've heard a billion times. The Fortin one I haven't heard that much. You know, Cessnock, we all play for the Hornets soccer team. There's some good club songs out there. Southie, probably not one of the good ones. I have to be honest. It's no fire in the hole, that's for sure. Under 23, South Cardiff 0, drawing Wall's End FC 0. There it is. Big game, but you know, finals like atmosphere and a 0-0 draw. But I'll give them credit, this was a very entertaining 0-0 draw. You'll see some of the highlights here, maybe. A typically even start, the cagey start, whatever you like to call it. Nick Doyle pulled off two or three decent saves in the first half to keep Wall's End level. Southie saw Jack Parkinson forced off injured Tom Wooten, replacing him. I think it was a leg injury. I didn't actually see him go off. I saw Tom Wooten go on, and no, I think he limped off over the other side of the field or something, but he went off injured. Decent free kick from Trent Milton right on half-time. Caused some panic for South Cardiff, as you can see here, but Jackson Robb would boot it to safety. An arm wrestle of a first half, with neither team taking advantage. Chances were more regular in the second half, I thought. Ben McCabe missed an open net chance to get his 10th goal of the season. Agonisingly wide, Emmanuel Okumu missed a decent chance. Aaron Gunn had a chance off a free kick in the 70th minute that was saved well by Nick Doyle, as you can see here. And then Trent Lamborn had a chance late on as well. Walls End did have one or two chances, but Southie, I thought, had the better of the chances. Walls End stood firm. We'll talk about the result first before this injury, but Southie miss a chance, I think, to overtake Cooks Hill. I'm not sure what the points are, but they're probably heading to finals, but that... Let's not go there with that, because they've got Bell Swans and Lakes in the next 2 weeks. It's not done. It's not done at all in the 23s. There's some results we're going to talk about later, and there's some teams that are still alive. Southie definitely probably need to step up, and for Walls End, they needed to win this. They'll still like their chances, but I don't think that they're going to make it now as a result of today's result. It's a long way back in next week against Cahiba. Apologies to Cessnock City, and I'll probably say it again during the week. I was going to head out to Cessnock and Westie next week, but I've changed that. I'm going to go to Walls End and Cahiba, because the games there at this stage of the season, those games are incredibly important, especially the 23s. That is going to be quite a game between two sides that are coming off a loss today. There's a spoiler for later. Big games next week in the 23s. Walls End will be without Jackson Manning. This was a somber ending to the game, really. 79th minute. Jackson Manning was... I haven't watched the replay. I think he was just collected. It was an awkward challenge. No malice in it. And there's the young Walls End defender, a potential torn calf muscle in literally the final minute of the game. And, you know, that's... I think it was a 76th minute, to be fair. I think that's just really... That really sucks, for the lack of a better term. I was nearby some Walls End fans. His dad was one of those, and, you know, he's going to miss the finals, Jackson Manning, to head overseas to a tournament in China. And this, you know, that's in 2 weeks, and this really puts that in doubt, you know, all that, the travel, the money for the travel, and, Jackson Manning has been probably one of the best players at Walls End FC this year in any grade. And that's a really sucky way for the season end, for the regular season end for him. Hopefully he'll fight the clock and make that tournament over there, because that's a big opportunity for him. And you definitely don't want to see someone miss something like that, but a somber ending to the game, nonetheless. And yes, Walls End, frustrated, 0-0 draw. In first grade, South Cardiff 1 were defeated by Walls End FC 2. It didn't take long for Walls End to get on the front foot. Cameron Tapp ironically tapped it in. And there was about 5 or 6 different people who did that joke. Ben Nichols, the 23s coach, was one of those. And I said, yes, I've heard it already 4 or 5 times. I didn't actually see the goal. I think I saw the back end of it, but Tapp with the opener. Trent Richards made a first-grade start, but at the position of right-back, which I thought was a little bit weird considering he's one of the top goal scorers at the club. At the end of the day, he was pretty decent at right-back. The visitors got that early lead. It was another arm wrestle for the majority of the first half. Southie had the better chances, but the likes of Tiga Marcus were proving trouble. David Hodgson, you know, just, you know, chirpy and just generally being annoying for the Southie defenders, really. That's what Hodjo's about. Not the most incredible workload, you know, getting back, but definitely led the team well. There's not too many players in the league who can play a coach, and David Hodgson is one of those players. you know, maybe not on the level of Andre Gumprecht, but he's definitely, you know, definitely got a similar sort of pedigree. And yes, Hodjo's Walls End side, they were doing well, but then Southie hit back early in the second half. Cameron Traic equalised for the Gunners on the back of some sloppiness from Walls End. Really, it was quite poor. Turnovers and just, you know, not enough players tracking back. No midfield at one point put the defenders under enormous pressure. Walls End were given a penalty. Mikael Breckenridge giving away that penalty. I didn't actually see this. I think I was going to charge this iPad, which is still only 18%. So I was sort of just ducking into the canteen area there at Southie, and I missed it. But from an independent source who wasn't involved with either team, they said that it probably could have even been a red card. I'm not sure. I didn't see it. I think that might have been a lie. I don't know. It was only a yellow, and the yellow was for the back chat. It wasn't actually for the challenge, I don't think. I'm going to confirm that, actually. I'm going to do that right now. Let's just confirm it. Dissent is the yellow card. So the penalty conceded there. David Hodgson stepped up to the spot. And I'll give Hodjo credit. It was a very well-taken penalty. And most days it would end up in the net, but Mikael Breckenridge is a pretty decent goalkeeper. And, you know, he guessed right. Well, he guessed left in this situation, but he guessed the right side and he made that save, and it was a brilliant save. But, you know, at the end of the day, the goalkeepers, it is a 50-50. Breckenridge wins out there. The dogfight resumed with both sides producing a chance every now and then. Walls End defending very well. As I said, their midfield left a lot to be desired today at times. Southie arguably produced more go forward than the visitors. There was a lot more room for Southie in the midfield area. David Hesimovic, you know, Winston Oku causing trouble. Nick Pepper until he went off causing some trouble. Josh Casey as well, a decent young player there that plays quite well. The game was on the line. 5 minutes to go. Enter Tiga Marcus time, and he'd score a goal to win it for Walls End. Tiga Marcus definitely scoring some important goals this year. And a quality effort from a young Southie side, you know. As I said, I'm not sure of the ages of Cameron Traic and whatnot, but I know Cam Herring's young, I believe, and Josh Casey the same. Nick Pepper, Winston Oku. I don't know what competition they're going to be in next year. They couldn't even tell me, Southie, but Andrew Packer's got a decent side there, and I think there's a lot to look forward to at that club. I really do. I think they've got a decent side. And, you know, that towards the back end of the year, they've been putting in some decent efforts, and they're unlucky today probably not to get a result. So we'll move on. I better get some water, or else I am not going to be able to get through this next bit. Um, 11:18 at night. Slightly later tonight than it was last night, which is a bit of a shame because I was so far ahead of time. So I don't know if I'm going to get the editing done this week or not. We'll see what happens. None of these games were filmed. So, also, just a reminder that the Westie games weren't filmed due to excessive amounts of wind. I really like the word excessive. And excessive was probably an understatement for the amount of wind at Westie yesterday. It was quite something. Let's go around the grounds now today. Three games in the under-17s, first of all, Lake Macquarie City 2 defeating Cessnock City 1. And there were some keen eyes from Lake 17s yesterday at Johnson Park. The likes of Curtis McRitchie, Brady McRitchie, Preston Cunningham, a couple of the 19s as well. But yeah, a couple of those 17s players were there at Westie, watching Westie. You know, still the premiership race is still well alive, and Lakes needed to win today. Adam Mitchell gave them an early lead. And yeah, that's how it would stay for a very long time. Cessnock, I had sort of a feeling that they might have copped a few goals in this one, looking at their recent form, but they played very well, put in a quality effort, and then with 5 minutes to go, it was still 1-0, which for that long, you know, that all that second half, you know, players, I think Will Forbes played, I haven't checked the team sheet, but, you know, players like Will Forbes, you know, Aaron Comerford, you know, all those sort of players who can just score, like, you know, from any, you know, anything could have happened today at 1-0 for that long. And, you know, Westie came incredibly close yesterday to costing them, not costing themselves, but being, you know, losing that premiership race. So Lakes just got there today. I say that, I don't know how it played out, but that's how it looks on the team sheet nonetheless. Curtis McRitchie scored with 5 minutes to go to put him 2-0 up. And then Zach Kronholm, a decent young player at Cessnock, would get a goal back immediately, and that's how it would stay, 2-1. Up at Singleton, the Strikers 0 were defeated by Cahiba FC 2. Overall, a somewhat scrappy, hard-fought affair. The telling moments came in quick succession. Singleton fought hard for the first probably half hour or so, but Cahiba were given a sniff, some lapses from Singleton. And, you know, it's been like that this year. This is a decent side, Singleton, but they've just, they drop off sometimes. And, you know, they've had some pretty bad defeats at home as of late. The 5-0 comes to mind. This one, both goals coming in the space of 2 minutes of each other. Henry Gibson and Kai Condon scoring for Cahiba. And, you know, I had someone from Singleton message me the scores, and I was at South Cardiff. People probably thought, what is he doing? Because I was just there, you know, flicking the screen like a madman, because I wanted to see that result, because I knew in the 17s it was a big, big result today for Cahiba, because it takes them into the top four. At the expense of Cooksville United, Cahiba FC are into the top four. And, you know, I'm involved at Cooksville, so that's a little bit hard to take, but I'll take it, because this Cahiba side's quality. And to be quite fair, I don't really mind which one of them gets into the finals, because they're both good teams, and whoever gets there will deserve to be there. But Cooksville, it's, yeah, they really, again, if Cahiba win every game from here, they are in the finals. There's two games remaining. So next week, Wallsend versus Cahiba in the 17s. It's a brilliant day at Wallsend next week. I tell you, that's why I'm going there. And apologies to Cessnock, apologies to Toronto, even for their old boys' day. I'm sure I would have enjoyed being at both those games. I can't be everywhere. And look, I think there's too many people out there who'd say, you know, who'd blame me for going to watch Wallsend and Cahiba. That 17s game, it's going to be something. It's potential finals preview, Cahiba's season on the line. The same can be said in the 23s. In the 19s, Cahiba 19s looking to assure the final spot. And then in first grade, it's the potential finals preview. So, well, actually, no, it's not. We'll talk about first grade later, but the semi-finals are set, in my opinion, for first grade. And it's not Cahiba and Wallsend, but it's going to be a good day next week. And yes, as I said, Cahiba's 17s team are into the top four with two games remaining. Cooksville will be fuming with that, but they've got themselves to blame after that late loss yesterday at West Wallsend. We move over to Fortin, where the Fortin Redbacks 2 were defeated by Toronto Awaba 3. Now, I tipped Fortin here. I was asked, why did I tip Fortin here? And I explained it, because this side's got some decent players. They don't deserve the wooden spoon, but as far as I'm concerned, now they're going to get it, because they've got some tough... They've got Cooksville next week, and then they've got Cessnock in the final round. I think they're 4 points behind, so essentially they've got to get a result against Cooksville next week, which I really don't think they will. Especially with Cooksville, they need to win. There's nothing. There's no draw, there's no loss. They have to win next week in the 17s. So Fortin, big comeback now to avoid the wooden spoon. They started well, Gabriel Halpin getting an early goal, but Charlie Atkinson equalised, and then right on half time, that cheap half time goal. I don't know. I'm saying cheap for Fortin's sake. It's a very bad time to concede. But Caleb Trimboli for Toronto, no better time to score. And then Trimboli would score again in the second half. A player who's been pretty good this year when he gets a chance. That made it, sorry for the dramatic 5 second pause, I lost my spot there. That made it a challenge for Fortin, and despite a goal from a quality winger by the name of Aiden Hesketh, it wasn't to be for Fortin. In the under-19s, late Macquarie City 3 defeated Cessnock City 2. A fast start to this game. Goals to Darko Nishic and Reese Paprocki. Had the scores level at 15 minutes, and then Brock Torrent would fire Lakes into the lead as they chased a minor premiership. Big game for Bell Swans. There's that Bell Swans shirt in the background, actually. Bell Swans v Westie on Tuesday night. I wouldn't be surprised to see some people from Lakes there watching that one. I did see a 19s coach. I'm not going to say who from what team. I don't think you want to get named, but I did see a 19s coach today from a coach who I've never seen at other games that don't involve his team that was scoping out some games today. So it's that time of the year, I guess, going into finals. There's coaches that, you know, they like. And even if they don't, they can always watch the game on Nui Sports if it's filmed. I've had that as well. I've had coaches tell me that they just sit there, watch this coverage and pinpoint who to pick out and whatnot. Not every coach is like that, but some are. So yes, 2-1 to Lakes after about 20 minutes. The game would take a very serious and worrying turn. Cessnock's keeper, Braden Bean, the 7-inch keeper as well. He was injured in a collision, a facial injury. I'm not sure exactly how this played out. Imagining that he collided with a Lakes player. I'm not sure if it's sort of like a Mark Birigidi situation or something on the ground. But nonetheless, I got the message there, and that's what came to my mind, was Birigidi's carrying 5 of his teeth off the field, and probably 2 others up here and near his eyes. That was a pretty sickening collision that day. So yeah, I was a bit worried when I got this message here, and as I said, so many abandoned games lately. So the game was stopped around the 30th minute, and ambulance and whatnot, and the game would restart. So I don't really want to say let's talk about that first. I don't really want to say credit to those that helped him out and all that. Credit to the ambulance for being, I was at Cook's Hill in round 1 when an ambulance took 2 hours to get to the field, and Hamilton ambulance stations around the corner. I'm not sure if anyone called them. I don't know, that's not my job, but that was, sometimes you have to wait for ambulances, but so that was good. It was good that it was dealt with quickly and that the game resumed. The last thing neither team would have wanted to play a replay. And, there's been a lot of abandoned games in the 19s this year, and it's that grade. It's no other grade has had this. There has been serious injuries in other grades, but none of them have resulted in abandonments. So it was good to see this game restart. But, yes, I got a message by the Cessnock coach, and he did say the goalkeeper was he's not in and out of consciousness, but he definitely wasn't really all there, and it'd be quite worrying. He's probably concussed as well, probably a serious concussion there, and a chipped tooth. Probably could have been a lot worse, to be honest. You see goalies lose teeth every now and then. It's part and parcel of being a goalkeeper, and it's exactly why I wouldn't be a goalkeeper. Sliding in on the ground with boots flying in and whatnot. So, well wishes to Braden Bean. And Lakes, actually, I'll give this a mention now, because I don't know what they publicly said. I haven't been on their Facebook page in a few hours, but Lakes, credit to them for putting up the live scores. They're the only club that do it. We'll talk about some scores later on at Lakes where I kept refreshing and there kept being another goal, another goal, another goal, but that's in first grade. We'll talk about that soon. But Lakes, one of the committee members there always emails me team sheets and whatnot, and he did send some regards on behalf of the club to Braden Bean. Definitely, you don't want to see that. But it is part and parcel of being a goalkeeper. Kudos to those who helped him out, physios and coaches and whatnot, whoever. I'm not sure who helped him out in that situation, but no doubt he wouldn't have been on his own there. A lot of care given at Cessnock. The game would resume eventually in the second half. Liam Schulte put in Lakes 3-1 up, and a goal with 9 minutes remaining to Cessnock's Kyle Gillis, I'm going to say. I always say Gillis. Maybe it's Gillis. I don't. Give me pronunciation lessons next year. He gave the Hornets a sniff, but Lakes would hold on for a determined victory that boosted their hopes of finishing top of the table. I didn't mention earlier that there will be probably some Lakes players going to watch Bell Swans and Westie on Tuesday night. Bell Swans, if they win that and then win the last two, they're the premiers. Lakes need Bell Swans to drop points. And Lakes also need to beat South Cardiff in the final round, which it's not a done deal because South Cardiff are quite a good team in the 19s. So very interesting there, the premiership's still alive. Singleton 1 defeated by Cahyber FC 2. Oliver Moody put the first half that was scoreless, very hard fought by both teams. Oliver Moody put Singleton ahead early in the second half. It was cancelled out quickly by Jared Watkins. And then an understrength Singleton side, they didn't have Nathan Hall, they didn't have Tom Golding, the captain. They'd go down to defeat as Luke Jones scored a quality goal from long range. A big win for Cahyber that all but assures a final spot, in my opinion. Matt Moncrief's team, they got Wall's End next week, they got Toronto the week after that. They shouldn't have too many problems there, if they're serious about their championship credentials. They win both those games, in my opinion. So big win for Cahyber today, a very important win in the 19s. Singleton's season now over as a result. A side that started so well in pre-season, they looked well drilled, well coached. I don't know where it's gone too wrong. They just haven't shown up for the teams above them. They've had some inconsistent results, but you know, Nathan Hall's been a breakout player this year. Tom Golding's had a great year. There's others in that team, you know. I can't think. Nick Huff is probably, yeah, he's probably their player of the year there, to be honest. Or Nathan Hall and then Nick Huff. And, you know, even Oliver Moody. There's some decent players in that team, and it's a shame. Not everyone can make the finals, you know. I'm not going to sit here and say, you know, every team should make the finals. That'd be nice, but that's not how this competition works, and they didn't get there, so that's it at the end of the day. And two teams who never really came close to finals in this grade, Fortin and Toronto, played today, 2-2 draw. Wooden Spoon actually was more the theme here. Brady Broderick continued some scoring form. That goal last week, how good was that? You know, I was showing some people at TAFE who just like, you know, what do you do at the football on the weekend? I do a music course. And I'm like, you know, this is one of the goals that was scored on the weekend. And, you know, they're like, oh, that's pretty good, you know. So, there you go. That was a great goal last week. I was very, very happy with the footage as well. Very decent. You know, there's been a few goals that we've got awful angles of. Lachlan Donnelly joined him on the score sheet, but it was actually Toronto who took the lead twice. Josh Davies with two goals. Donnelly's goal, I believe, Toronto said that it was a little bit cheap, I don't know, but nonetheless Toronto probably feel hard done by for not getting the result there, and in my opinion that almost seals Toronto's fate as Wooden Spooners. They have to pick up a result next week against Westie or the week after against Cahyber, which I can't see them winning either of those. So Toronto 19s, you know, they did have a very sort of emotional game last week, which probably took a lot out of them, but they would have been playing with a lot of heart in this one, and 2-2 was the end result. Disappointing though for Toronto not to get the 3 points. Under 23s, Lake Macquarie City 0, drawing Cessnock City 0. Quite a surprising result when this one came through. Lakes obviously frustrated not to continue their good form, but honestly, it doesn't really matter. They're the minor premiers, but they need to be, you know, they've got one more game and then they're in the semi-final. So, you know, it's, they've got, I think they got the bye next week, and then they've got South Cardiff. So against South Cardiff, they need to step up, because that game against South Cardiff is going to be an all top four clash. So, you know, I'm a real believer in teams, you know, stepping up just before the finals and getting into the right sort of action. I'm not sure how this one played out. I didn't really get too much of a report. I just got the team sheets. But I can tell you, I looked at the Cessnock lineup, and they'll be delighted with leaving Macquarie Field with a point. You know, Will Forbes started, and you know, he's a good player, but obviously he's probably not, you know, he's a 17s player. He's starting 23s. And I think there was a couple others as well that started. A couple of 19s guys came off the bench. It was an understrength squad. Matt Zeckel was also out in goals. I'm not sure. He might have played first grade. I don't know. But no, I'm getting confused. He might have been in goals. No, Shannon Atwell. I don't know. Whoever was in goals, they kept the clean sheet anyway. But yes, there was a few out. You know, Skip O'Hearn played, but there was a few experienced players out in that Cessnock team today. That's twice this year they've played Lakes, 2-2 draw and a 0-0 draw. Lakes, you know, they're the runaway premiers in this grade. They couldn't beat Cessnock this year, so there's some bragging rights for Cessnock. But that's all it is, because they're not going to make the finals, and, you know, but a decent result today. To leave Macquarie Field with a point, you can't really go wrong with that. Singleton Strikers 1, defeating Cahyber FC 0. Both teams needed a win here. And Singleton, give them credit. Last week, they produced a big win against Wall's End. And, you know, the week before I said that their season's over. Now I will sit here and I'll say I was wrong, and their season is definitely not over yet. Cahyber defending, I think it was either 12 or 13 game unbeaten streak. I'm not quite sure, it's one of those. It's not anymore. Singleton would get a late first half goal, a decent run forward by Rob Field, and then a finish from Tate Edwards. Ryan Gehoe working very hard in the second half in goals, and Cahyber fall to a defeat. It had to come. It's been so long since they've lost a game. It was always going to happen eventually. They did have a couple changes up front today, which they couldn't get a goal, they couldn't get a win, and now, next week, they play all or nothing football against Wall's End FC. And I'm serious about that, I'm dead serious. They know next week is it. Next week in my mind is an elimination final. That's brilliant. I can't wait for next week, Wall's End versus Cahyber. Match of the round in nearly every grade. Well, definitely in the 17s and 23s in first grade. 19s is probably a better match somewhere else. I'm not sure. I can't think who else is playing. But I tell you what, that game in the 23s, and that will be filmed as well. I'll film that. We'll film that game. I'll make sure that's the pick of the day, pick of the games. All or nothing for Cahyber, and for Singleton. Next week they are at Toronto, which they should win, and then they'll be playing Cooks Hill. And if Cooks Hill lose to Fortin next week, then, you know, the door is open for Singleton Strikers in the 23s. It's definitely not over yet. Fortin 1, defeating Toronto Awaba 0 in the 23s. So close yet so far for Toronto. They played all right, I've heard. James Perazzini giving Fortin a goal in the 42nd minute. That's all they needed. They saw off the challenge. The defending champions 1-0, but again, they're out of the finals, so it's not really, you know, Toronto obviously going to finish with the wooden spoon, so not really that much. It's a result, but it's not really a result that affects anything too big. We'll talk about this game last. We'll go to Singleton, where the Singleton Strikers 2 defeated Cahyber FC 0. And I mean, wow. I don't know what the Cahyber lineup was. I know what the Singleton lineup was. So Cahyber may have had people out. You know, there's been a lot of players went up to Splendour in the Grass this week. Westy had just billions of players out. Cooks Hill did. You know, Cessnock had a few out today. But Cohiba probably did have one or two out. But Singleton, these players, Jackson Cox, club captain, Corey Cleaver, Claudin Akmatai, were all out. And they've gone and beaten Cohiba, which I think that is massive. That is really a quality result for David Willoughby's side. And that's probably, in my mind, apart from the FFA Cup heroics, that's probably their best win of the season. Sam Ford limped off early as well, which made it even tougher because Rob Field played the entire 23s and then he had to back up. Jackson Huff played the entire 23s and then first grade at centre back. He hasn't played much first grade this year either, Jackson Huff. So what an effort from Singleton. With their backs against the wall, Singleton producing one of their best performances of the season. Kieran Burrell, what a player this guy is. You know, the frustration, the disappointment in losing two of their imports earlier this season, and then they went and got Kieran Burrell. I don't know whose contact he was, where they got him, how they got him, but he is an import, and what an addition he has been to this squad. Brilliant player to watch, and for any NPL teams watching, don't, you know, give him money. You go and pay his transfer fee. Don't steal him from under their noses. I don't like seeing good players in this division get poached mid-season, but it's the end of the season now, and I wouldn't be surprised to see Kieran Burrell playing NPL, or, you know, I don't know if he's staying around the area. I'm not really. He's enjoying his time at Singleton, I believe. That's what I've noticed. And he scored their first today and set up their second, Nathan Hall. Perfect setup for Nathan Hall to score. And I think that's, what, 25 goals or something this year, 23, 24, I don't know. Nathan Hall can't stop scoring this season. And it's not very often he's scored in first grade, but when he does, it's very important. A team effort from Singleton. Cohiba, no reply as they watch their premiership hopes go down the drain. And in my mind, that's it. That's the first grade semi-finals. It's going to be Lakes versus Walls End. And Lakes first versus Walls End fourth. And Cohiba v Bell Swans are still got to decide who's going to finish second, who's going to finish third. But those are your semi-finals in my mind. Fortin Redbacks today, 6, defeated Toronto Wobba 2. Same result from round 9. And similar from Toronto. I didn't get the team sheet, so I don't really know who was in, but, you know, Toronto should be losing 6-2. It's just a poor day at the office, and it's happened a lot this year, but there's a lot to look forward to at Toronto, so I wouldn't look too much into it. Nathan McAllister grabbing a hat-trick to move within a goal at the Golden Point at Fortin Park. Jack Halverson on 13, McAllister on 12, Josh Davies on 12. So it's, you know, it's going to be interesting. I'm going to watch Fortin play next week at the Affield, so the Golden Boot's still up for grabs. Liam Penglaze, Tanner White and Jamie Subit, the other goal scorers on the day. For Toronto, the two Tims, Tim Stone and Tim Salter, grabbing goals. 2-0 down at halftime and losing 6-2. Not good enough for Toronto. You know, you can't really glaze over that. They've got Old Boys Day next week, and they really won't want to lose like that on Old Boys Day, so hopefully a bit of performance for their sake. And Fortin, in my mind, they confirm their spot as the best of the rest. The top four is obviously decided, but Fortin are going to finish fifth, and they're going to finish above the middle pack. But at the end of the day, that's probably going to mean little to Darryl McAllister, who probably would have wanted to make the finals this year. And, you know, if they had kept more consistent, they've got a side that's capable of making the finals. You know, I don't know what's happening at Fortin next year, whether McAllister coaches, whether Nathan McAllister's there playing, whatever the situation is. But, you know, there's a lot of clubs where it's unclear what's going to be happening next year. I don't even know if Fortin's going to be in the competition, to be honest. If there's any club that I'm worried about dropping out of this competition, it's Fortin. And people can ask me why, and I'll say, you know, it's their ground. They're not the biggest club going. I don't know what their finances are. I don't know that. You know, there's a lot I don't know about it. But as for the actual ground itself and, you know, the junior base, I'm not sure how strong it is there. And you know, Fortin, I don't know. I don't know if they're going to be there next year, but if they are, then they're definitely, if they keep this side together, then they're one to watch, you know, given that. Last but not least, we have to talk about it. For Cessnock City's sake, we have to talk about it. They're not going to enjoy this. Lake Macquarie City 8 defeating Cessnock City 1. And there's not too much I can say about this. It was pure, unadulterated annihilation. That's Fox Sports-esque description of this today. Lake's Look, I'm going to be honest with you. It was an understrength Cessnock side. There was a few names that weren't there, but this should not have happened. This is just poor from Cessnock. They just got absolutely trampled in the first half and couldn't find a way back. Stephen Ross-Pigolosi opening the scoring. Sam Walker then had a hat trick inside 25 minutes. In the space of 14 minutes, Sam Walker scored 3 goals to all but seal the Golden Boot again this season, and he's got it. And unless Blake Green goes and scores 12 goals in the next game, Sam Walker is your Golden Boot winner in first grade, and very well deserved. Started the season slowly, compared to last year, you know, but he's getting close towards 30 goals now, so you can't go wrong with that. Ross Pigolosi scored in the 29th minute to make it 5-0, then right on half-time. He'd score again, so he also got a hat-trick. So there you go. Kyle Clark scored on the 44th minute to give Cessnock, you know, a goal. That's all it was. It wasn't anything else. It was 6-1 at half-time. And, you know, I was at South Cardiff watching the game there, and I went on the Lakes Facebook page, and it said, Lakes 6-1 first half, and I didn't know how far it was going to go. It didn't go too much further, fortunately for Cessnock. Joseph Holt scoring, and then Sam Walker making it 4 goals. 8-1. One of the worst defeats of the season in first grade. I think it might even be the worst in first grade. That's a shocker. That's an absolute shocker for Cessnock, who had turned a corner recently, beating Walls End at home, frustrating Bell Swans a couple times earlier this year. They were down 3-0 by Bell Swans last week. They were just completely blown off the park today, and the wooden spoon is inbound. It's a long way back to avoid that now. A quick word, you know, a severely lackluster display, but as I said, they were under strength, so I don't want to, you know, say too much about it, because there's not much. But in saying that, 8-1 is, there's no excuses for 8-1. And I said the same thing about the Jets youth last week with the 10-2. There's no excuses for getting smashed by 7 or 8 goals. Just outplayed on the day completely. As for Lakes, though, you know, I thought we'll talk about Cessnock first. We'll get that out of the way. We'll talk about Lakes, because today they wrapped up the Premiership in the most convincing, Farah fashion you will ever see a team wrap up a Premiership in. And I'm talking like anywhere. There's no teams that just, you know, to win a trophy 8-1. Of course, they weren't presented with the trophy today, but you know, they wrapped up the Premiership today. And it's not the minor Premiership, and I'll complain that. I'll argue that all day long. It's a Premiership. They were the first past the post, and if we were in England, Lakes would be the champions. And they've been, I don't want to say they've been the best side all year, because they haven't beaten Bell Swans yet. They've been beaten twice by Bell Swans. And if you're going to ask me right now for a grand final tip, I'm going to say Lakes v Bell Swans, and I'm going to say that I can't wait to see that. But, yeah, so they may not be the best side yet, because they still haven't beaten Bell Swans, but they've been the most consistent, especially in recent weeks, and that is deserved. But in saying that, they're obviously going to NPL next year, and I keep saying that, love them or hate them, Lakes, they're going to the NPL, and it's wrong if they don't, because they've deserved it. Valentine got every other team every other year gets promoted if they finish top, So Lakes deserve that, given that much. But in all seriousness, though, they're hitting peak form at the right time of the year. But I think, in my mind, for late Macquarie City, anything short of a grand final berth, you know, if they lose the semi-finals, then that's a disappointing end. You know, that's what happened last year. So they'll be wanting to get to that grand final and get that first grand final win in about 10 years or so. And, you know, set up a potential promotion push for next season. It's definitely going to be an interesting final series. And Lakes today have wrapped up the premiership in the new FM First Division First Grade to go with the premiership in the under-23s and potentially the premiership in the under-17s, but I still think Bell Swans will get it in the 19s. We'll see what happens there. But that's that. Nui Sports TV. Actually, I will say Tuesday night, Bell Swans v Westie. Westie v Bell Swans, technically. It is at Westie. Same can be said for Wednesday night. Next Saturday at the Affield. Next Sunday at the Gardens. Lots of stuff to get through. All those games. Two more weeks and then the finals, so it's getting very, very serious this time of the year. And a quick thank you to South Cardiff FC today for their hospitality. You know, the free jacket, the free shirt, the free food, all that. You know, I don't call it buying my love, because, you know, I really like Southie, some of the players there. Decent club, and I'm a bit annoyed with myself that I didn't go there more often earlier in the season, but it was a good day today, and I really appreciate the chance to come out there and work alongside the Gunners, and look forward to doing it again if I get the chance. As for that, this has been episode 26 of Nui Sports TV. I'm Ty Stebbin, and I will see you probably during the week on a live stream or the Zone League show or some video somewhere. I'll see you then anyway. Thank you.